I have been a fan of films for as long as I can remember. Ever since I was a 7-year-old boy who walked into the theater and experienced a beautifully constructed opening title sequence for Spider-Man 2 in 2004, I feel my love for the art form has only flourished. Sure, my film-going experience must have started much earlier than that, but it's this sequence that I vividly remember. Maybe it was the iconic Marvel comic book flip, the thrilling score, or the detailed animation of the title sequence. To this day, I can still remember walking out of the theater with an awestruck expression on my face, and still not believing that the experience was real. With every other movie I've seen since then, my love and passion for the entire craft of filmmaking has only propagated, and I have grown to appreciate and respect the entire process involved when it comes to making a film. I've grown to respect different genres of films, made a conscious effort to understand the evolution the industry had to go through as a whole, understood the complexities of the filmmaking process, and how each aspect of filmmaking complements the other to come out with a cohesive product in the end that's able to connect with the masses. I have made a conscious effort to expose myself to Bollywood musicals, Hollywood westerns, complex Korean dramas, subtle Japanese storytelling, realistic and allegorical Iranian films, and many more. This exposure has allowed me to understand the various perspectives from which the world may approach the same problem, but at the same time, I'm also able to appreciate how ultimately these are all just human stories being told and portrayed by human beings for other human beings. We all have something that we can relate to in these stories, and ultimately the only difference that seems to be is the language that the story is being told in. I feel like with each movie I watch, I can identify and appreciate a new facet of filmmaking. I understand how each story being told usually involves multiple people coming from their own backgrounds and expertise in the craft, working together to achieve a singular distinct vision that's laid out by the director, and this vision needs to be rigid. The film should already be laid out in the head of the visionary, otherwise the film is just going to be a disaster. M. Night Shyamalan is a great example for this. In his movies where there's a distinct vision, the films have been akin to masterpieces. And when the same director has an unfocused vision for the film, he has come out with some of the worst films of all time. This led me to truly understand how important the director's vision is for the film. How they almost need to be a conductor at an orchestra, understanding how each instrument works and how everything should come together in harmony to create a beautiful piece in the end. One such visionary director that I want to talk about today is Ben Stiller, and his film, The Secret Life of Walter Mitty. Although he doesn't have an extensive catalog compared to other established directors, from whatever films he has directed, I have been rather impressed by the concepts and characters he has tried to tackle in his films. From the delusional actors who give themselves PTSD for their craft, to the lovable cable guy who goes too far off the deep end, I have appreciated the ways in which Ben Stiller likes to tackle these extremities of human psyche in his films, and how he's still able to get the audience to sympathize and relate to these eccentric characters. In The Secret Life of Walter Mitty, Ben decides to take on telling the story of a common man. A person like you and me, a person with dreams and aspirations who gets bogged down from the realities of life to get stuck in a monotonous job. Due to circumstances that were out of his control, he enters this life of tedium, spending his days in the offices of Life magazine, developing photos being sent to him by the star photographer of the company, Sean O'Connell, who is out in the wild exploring the world and searching and photographing exotic subjects. The incident that gets Walter to break out of his life of tedium is when one of the photographs ends up missing from the latest reel that Sean sends to him. And since this is the last physical publication of the magazine before the company shifts into a digital format, the responsibility falls into Walter's hands to find Sean and track down the quintessential photo for the cover. This film doesn't follow the typical route of the hero's journey that every popular film in Hollywood seems to have adopted since Star Wars. In this film, Walter doesn't go on his journey till 36 minutes into the film. Till that time, we are able to understand his character, his motivations, why he is where he is, what his aspirations are, and why we as an audience should feel and care for this character. I don't want to reveal anything more about the story, and I feel the less revealed about the story, the better it is for the audience to explore the film by themselves for the first time. I do want to talk about some technical aspects of the film and point out some of the reasons why I think the movie was underappreciated. The characters. I wanted to start this off by talking about the characters in the film. I believe that the film has very likable and relatable characters. Some are better than others, but the different methods in which these characters bounce off of each other, there is a reasonable cohesiveness to the film. And I really like how all of them come together to tell a likable and warming story. Walter is our protagonist of the film. A daydreamer who likes to spend more of his time in his fantasies rather than his real life. He sees himself like we all like to see ourselves in our fantasies, as an action hero who saves a dog from a burning building, an Arctic explorer trouncing the Everest, and as a bootleg Benjamin Button who gets to grow old with the love of his life. Okay, that last thing might just be Walter, but you get my point. He's awkward when you first meet him, but the more you get to understand and realize where he's coming from, the more you get to relate with him. You see that he's just like you, a person who has had to put his dreams and goals on the sideline due to some responsibility or the other. It's not like he had the opportunity to choose, it's that he was never given the option in the first place. So as we go through the film, and we see how Walter can break out of his shell, we, as an audience, support and cheer for the character and support him throughout his journey. Ben Stiller does an amazing job portraying Walter in the film. He brings the nuances of playing an ordinary, witty, but awkward individual in his normal life, but he knows how to turn it up to 100 when he portrays Walter in his fantasies. There is an incredibly charming way how Walter is portrayed in the film, and is the best part about the movie. Then we have Cheryl, who is wonderfully portrayed by Kristen Wiig. She becomes the main motivator for Walter to break out of his shell and get on his quest to find Sean and recover the cover photo for the magazine. She plays the perfect girl next door. She perfectly bounces off of Walter's character, and I feel the chemistry between Kristen Wiig and Ben Stiller is amazing in the film. Although she doesn't have a huge part in the film, she comes in at the opportune moments in the film to uplift Walter's character and motivate him to explore the road less traveled. I think the reason why I like Walter and Cheryl together is because she becomes a rock when Walter is bogged down by his insecurities and is hesitant to break out of his shell. She is the one who pushes him to go to Greenland to find Sean. She is the one who explains to him the actual meaning of the Space Oddity song. She is the one who comes in Walter's fantasy and sings a rendition of the song in Greenland. I really like her character and understand why her and Walter can hit it off. Edna Mitty, played by Shirley MacLaine, who is Walter's mother in the film. She brings the perfect warmth required to play the character. We understand why Walter and Odessa both admire and respect her. We see how strong and independent leader of the family she is. She lets her children grow and flourish while recognizing their sacrifices. We understand how her traits and characteristics have been passed down and share the characteristics of her children. Edna Mitty is a wonderful character, and I totally understand why Walter and Odessa revere and cherish her. Finally, I want to talk about Sean, the elusive snow leopard of our story. Throughout the film, we are only told about him from other characters. We just have one photo to go off of regarding his appearance. The closer Walter seems to get to him, the further he would run off. He is as elusive as the exotic things he likes to take pictures of. And we, as an audience, get to be in Walter's shoes, getting disappointed as Sean keeps evading us. We get more invested as we realize that Walter might just be a couple of steps away from finding him. He is portrayed by Sean Penn, who does a wonderful job bringing the character to life. Technical aspects. I wanted to bring up the technical aspects of the film and appreciate the direction, cinematography, production design, and the score of the film. I wanted to highlight these aspects of the film because I believe that The Secret Life of Walter Mitty knocks it out of the park when it comes to blending all of these elements together. The first thing that jumps out towards me is the cinematography by Stuart Dryburgh and production design by Jeff Mann for the film. We see with the beautiful shot selection and set designs from the intro what Walter's responsibilities and aspirations are. The color in his apartments are just a mix of blues and grays, displaying the monotonous nature of his life. He is portrayed as a character in the background, staying far away from the camera, occupying only a fraction of the frame. In the first 3 minutes, we already understand the source of motivation for Walter without the character opening their mouth for the first line of dialogue. We realize that Walter has a lot of responsibilities and obligations to fulfill. He has a romantic interest, what he must become to woo that romantic interest. All of this being and Whedon, the starting shots of the film is ingenious directing from Ben Stiller's part, and it's one of the best forms of visual storytelling. Then we get the introductory credit sequence for the film where Walter walks through the streets of New York, accompanied by some beautiful cinematography and the original score of the film by Theodore Shapiro. The score is a beautiful amalgamation of instruments and humming together. It almost makes the audience feel like they're being trapped by a warm blanket before they are taken on this journey together with Walter Mitty. I have been using the music from the score throughout this video to give you a sense for how the audience feels while watching the film. The beautiful thing about the technical aspects of the film is that they evolve with the character of Walter Mitty. As Walter breaks out of his shell, the camera becomes more dynamic. We see more colors being added to Walter's life, with him traveling to these beautiful destinations in Iceland. His wardrobe becomes more colorful. We see the music change as well, matching with the tone and rhythm of the scene. The music can keep up with the rising action of the scene while complementing the beautiful and breathtaking landscape in the film. The team who created the score for the film absolutely knocked it out of the park. Some other technical aspects that I wanted to focus on was that the dialogue and editing in the film in some places is phenomenal as well. There is one scene that I wanted to point out. When Walter is in Greenland and he's having a conversation with Cheryl on the phone, and we realize how much there is that he feels he needs to say but restrains himself, doesn't become a movie mess. Instead, we see it in the acting and the perfectly written dialogue where we understand his relationship with his father and why we found Walter in his earlier predicament of living that mundane life. Then there is this transition scene near the beginning of the film where the film transitions into a fountain next to which Walter usually has his lunch. This moment was such a mind-bender for me when I rewatched the film. I realized that the editor had spoiled the movie for me from the beginning of the film, but I didn't care. Instead, I appreciated the film so much more for including a visual clue for the audience. One final piece of dialogue that stuck in my head from the film that I wanted to point out was from Sean. I let Mr. Penn do the honors.
Beautiful things don't ask for attention.
Conclusion. In the end, I hope with this explanation, I'm able to sway some of you to watch the film, some of you to disagree and provide me with some examples of your favorite films. I'm open to all discussion about films, and my channels are open to all who want to debate regarding the topic. I believe this film is a masterpiece because I feel it's a film that focuses on every aspect of filmmaking, that each aspect from the cinematography, production design, editing, music, etc. has been fine-tuned to perfection. Doesn't mean there aren't any unsavory parts of the film, but still, overall, the film is a perfect package, and I recommend this movie to anyone who is bored of the typical formula that is used by massive studios to churn out boring and repetitive crap to hypnotize the masses. This is Karumadi Productions. Thanks for watching the video, and I'll see you on the next one.